东师范也有。反正文史哲吧，我建议你们直接一起找就行了。师范类院校它如果一开，肯定就是从那个0405到06啊，包括01的都可能有。13类的我没想到今年也出了这么一些啊。看一下这个吧，中国电影艺术研究中心，就这个地方，它招的是戏剧与影视学专业。可以关注。再就是刚刚吧，咱们不是看了湖南工商大学的吗？湖南工商大学你看13设计学这一块它也是招调剂的呀。还有一个西安科技大学，它的艺术学院11号的时候发了一个接收调剂的公告，招的是设计这一块，然后有非全的，有全日制的，就大家都可以看一看。今天咱们就先到这儿，就是截止到今天中午吧，就找调剂的一些方法我也教了大家。今年调剂信息呢出的也都比较快，看得出来高校自己在这方面规范透明了不少，这其实是件好事儿。大家能加群就加群，能打电话打电话，找不到信息或者想知道一些调剂复习的小窍门的就过来关注我们。调剂系统正式开放前呢，大家最好能有相对明确的一些目标好去努力啊，千万别把复习落下。我再提醒大家，预祝大家今年都能顺利上岸。199管理类联考的复试和调剂，就是 MBA、MPA、MEM 等专业的考生，想知道怎么上岸，一定要看这期视频。先给大家讲一下199管理类联考的几个专业的调剂规则啊。199管理类联考的专业包括工商管理 MBA、公共管理 MPA、旅游管理 MPA、工程管理 MEM、会计 MPACC、图书情报、审计这几个专业。教育部对你们的调剂规定是，在满足调入专业报考条件且初试成绩同时符合调出专业和调入专业在调入地区的全国初试成绩基本要求的基础上，可申请相互调剂，但不得调入其他专业，其他专业的考生呢也不得调入以上专业。也就是说，第一，这几个专业可以互相调剂，就只要学校没特殊要求，比如一志愿报考专业须与调剂相同，那你肯定是可以调。第二，注意院校报考条件，MBA、MPA、MEM、MPA 等专业有工作年限限制，从毕业开始到入学时间应满足本科毕业满3年，专科学历毕业满5年。第三，你的成绩要同时符合调出专业和调入专业的国家线分数要求。大家要注意啊，管理类联考这几个专业现在是分开划线的，第一志愿专业的国家线成为了调剂的一道重要门槛。举个例子，如果报考 MPACC 你没有达到 MPACC 的国家线，就算达到了其他专业的国家线且满足了工作年限的要求，你也是没办法调过来的啊。简单来说，你只要同时符合第一志愿专业的国家线以及想要调剂专业的学校分数线啊，满足调剂专业的报考条件，那有调剂名额你就可以尝试调剂。接下来呢，我把计分方向和分数档位结合起来给大家讲一下调剂情况。就整个大方向上来分，199联考专业的调剂上岸情况可以分为三个档次。第一档是会计专硕 MPACC， 图书情报 MLIS， 还有审计 MAUD， 物流工程与管理专业全日制院校调剂分数最高啊，最抢手。根据往年的经验，以上几个专业全日制调剂机会非常少，对初试分数要求较高，所以这是199管理类联考里竞争比较激烈的一个方向，可以说是最激烈。如果分数你是在250以上且本科比较优秀，你们可以尝试调双非院校，通常会有一些这样的名额，比如会计专业去年沈阳理工大学、佳木斯大学是有缺额的。物流工程专业调剂名额相对要多一点，北京工商大学、北京华北理工大学、东北电力大学是有机会的。第二档次是在职全日制报考的 MBA、MPA、MEM、MPA 等专业。根据往年经验啊，一志愿全日制不饱和会有部分名额的。除了这几个专业内考生调剂外，一志愿报考会计等专业的考生如果工作年限达到要求，也会参与全日制 MBA、MPA 等方向的调剂，因此带来的竞争也是相对激烈的。这类调剂中呢，不乏211水平的院校，去年上海外国语、北京外国语、北京化工大学、华北电力大学等是有调剂机会的，但是211院校嘛，它普遍竞争是激烈的，初试230以上录取可能性会大一些。其他 A 区双非院校初试200以上录取都是有机会的啊。刚过国家线等一些比较危险的分数，你建议考虑相对普通的院校、边远地区的院校。第三档，非全日制调剂名额充足，985、211院校都有很多上岸机会的，绝大部分学校你过了国家线就有上岸的可能，因为院校太多了，我就不一一列举了，基本上瞅准你想要去的地方，找你喜欢的院校，直接去他们 MBA 中心问就行了。明白了各个分数档次都能往哪儿走，接下来我要说的是199管综调剂的重中之重，就是复试怎么翻盘。不管一志愿上岸还是调剂复试，你有没有把握住各个重要的时间节点，比如分数公布、国家线公布、调剂系统开启等，能不能做好全方位的这样的一个规划和准备，对你最终的结果影响很大的。比如去年我们有卡国家线进面排名垫底的上海交大和工大的同学来求助，还有全日制 MBA 擦边进华科复试的同学最后逆风翻盘啊，也有特别 极端的例子吧，比如调剂到211院校上海外国语全日制 MBA 的，还有160多分上岸 B 区211的，就这种同学啊，他们在复试过程中都是在我们老师的指导下下了很大的功夫，最终逆袭的。那么他们主要都做哪些工作呢？直接抄作业啊。首先根据去年的国家线、复试线和录取分数线，你先判断一下今年自己能不能进一志愿面试的清单啊，这决定了你复试准备的一个大方向。很多同学就是觉得这个每年有变化也没啥用啊，其实这个就是判断是比较重要的。根据我们往年考生数据来看，就是综合数据指标它肯定有参考价值，而且不会差的特别悬殊，你大概比较一下就能判断自己到底是一志愿还是两手抓还是直接走调剂了。其次，复试准备的四大块，政治、英语、专业课、综合问题。第一，因为管理类联考它的那个专业的初试是没有政治笔试的，所有院校它的复试中肯定都会考察考生的政治素养，分数占比约 10% 到 20%， 个别院校是合格性考核，不会计入总成绩，考察内容多为实证，难度是比较小的。如果看到问题你实在不知道怎么回答，就要围绕坚持党的领导，一切以人民利益为出发点，增强人民大众的幸福感、获得感、安全感来回答，一定不会出错的。第二，英语的面试它分数占比是在 10% 到 20% 之间，你要准备英文自我介绍、日常生活常见问题，还有一点专业的英文词汇，这块每天你抽出一个小时左右练一练就好，没必要占太多的复习时间，因为咱们分数占比真的不大主要拿分还是看专业课和综合素质啊。第三，专业课的复试占比可能是在30%-40%之间，近两年呢疫情影响，很多学校它是就是可能会有专业课笔试也放到了面试里，今年就是部分院校可能会有线下的笔试，大家是要注意一下，尤其是会计、审计、图情的同学，如果有一定早点准备，因为你们涉及的参考书目会比较多。在职的比如 MBA、MPA 等专业面试里面，考察的专业知识更加侧重于结合以往的工作经验，对问题提出自己的见解，针对这个问题你要讲清楚啊，它的现象是什么，什么原因造成的，解决方案哪几种，解决方案之间有什么优劣，你的表达要富有逻辑性，就是这种问题都没有标准答案的，你能输出自己的客观观点就可以了。最后一部分是综合素质考察这一块，综合素质这部分的分数占比也是 30%-40% 左右，这个范围啊，考察的范围比较广，有在校生，各位同学要明白，导师招你看中的除了像一般研究生那样的科研，还有你全方位的素质能力，所以除了梳理好你的一些科研的履历，比如像毕设呀、竞赛、大创，你还要准备一下自己的实习和活动经历，展现自己良好的专业能力和综合能力。对于有过工作经验的在职考生来讲，就 MBA 来举例吧，综合素质问答就是范围比较广啊。先来一段精彩的自我介绍，过往的成绩、工作履历、现任职位、为什么要考 MBA 等等，就这些问题，你要表现出自己的自信、沉稳，特别渴望来深造学习就可以了。复习过程中呢，你也要抓住这些核心要点，这个是对咱们来讲非常重要。最后细节制胜，这里面其实内容是比较多的，包括你的一些面试的礼仪举止、答题的策略等，今天我不展开讲，关注我们后续牛哥考研的复试团队会专门出相关的攻略讲复试。最后我跟大家讲一下199管理类联考调剂里面的终极难点，大家一定要注意听，你上不了岸十有八九就是适合在这些问题上了。第一，管理类联考专业肯定能跨专业调剂吧，原则上是的，这几个专业之间无论全日制还是非全日制其实都可以互相调，但 MBA、MPA、MEM、MPA 他们是有工作年限要求的，毕业年限达到要求即可调剂，非全日制跨专业调剂相对来说比较容易， MPA、MEM你只要满足调入地区的国家线就可以申请调剂到非全 MBA 专业，一志愿选择全日制的专业你也可以调非全日制。第二，全日制有哪些选择， MBA、 MPA、 MTA、 MEM 他们是有全日制的调剂机会的，对于某些毕业满3年的同学来说还有一个天窗是可以爬的，就是全日制 MBA、 MPA、 MEM 每年都有大学有全日制的空额啊，并且为非定向招生，有住宿、派遣和奖学金，甚至有的院校它的 MBA 和 EMBA 也是可以互调的，比如北京理工大学和中国人民大学。对于 MPA、CC 的考生来说，本专业内全日制调剂难度是很大的，这两年调剂全日制 MBA 成为一个热度较高的选择，要注意的是毕业年限的问题，那今年来说要求考生满足本科毕业满3年，也就是你20年6月前要毕业，专科毕业满5年，也就是18年6月前要毕业，学校卡的是学信网的信息，不是必须要有3年的工作经验，这一点大家一定记住。第三， A 区和 B 区之间如何调，考研地区它是按照所报考的学校所在的方向分 A 区和 B 区嘛， A 区的国家线会比 B 区高，你一志愿专业的总分和单科分数如果能过 A 区，那就 A 区 B 区的院校都可以调，调剂其他过线的专业都可以，如果只能过 B 区分数线，你就只能在 B 区的院校内调剂其他过线的专业。举个例子，假如今年国家线与去年国家线相同啊，某个考生第一志愿他报的是河北大学公共管理，成绩172，此时没过 A 区线，但是过了 B 区线，那你就只能在 B 区里面调了。 啊，你可以选择在本专业内调，调剂进入必须有 MPA 调剂名额的院校，你还可以选必须有调剂名额的 MBA 或者 MTA 专业。以上呢是199管综调剂的相关内容，从调剂的规则、分数档位、复试准备到终极难点，就是全是干货，没有废话，所以一定要收藏起来仔细看，关注我们一键三连，后续还有更多调剂信息干货解锁。
你还在为找不到最新考研调剂信息而发愁吗？这个系列为你精心搜集每日最新调剂信息，汇集各种渠道，让你考研调剂不迷路。本期视频内容含电子信息、计算机、数学、化学、动力工程、教育学、管理学、药学、生物学等相关专业，信息绝对保熟，请大家放心使用。第一个，南京信息工程大学发布了中外合作办学硕士研究生招生相关通知，预计调剂的专业有电子信息、大数据技术与工程、电子信息、沃特福德学院中外合作办学，预计调剂的名额还是比较多的。所属学院有自动化学院、软件学院、网络空间安全学院，经济条件比较好的同学可以关注，底下有联系方式。第二个，太原科技大学数学专业接收研究生调剂，研究方向有01微分方程与复杂系统、02数据分析与智能优化、03图论及应用、04算子理论和量子信息。下面是它的一个学科简介，有联系电话和邮箱，数学专业的小伙伴们可以留意。第三个，中石化的石油化工科学研究院，石油化工相关专业，想去科研院所的同学可以进研招网填写招生咨询问卷。第四个，西华大学能动学院发布了硕士研究生招生联系方式，这时候发布招生联系方式肯定是有招收调剂的需求，下面发布了相关专业代码及联系方式，包含动力工程及工程热物理、能源动力专硕、土木水利专硕，这些专业的考生们可以关注一下。第五个，三峡大学田家炳教育学院发布了2023年硕士研究生预调剂的通知，有教育学学硕和教育管理专硕，注意专硕要求大学本科毕业后有3年及以上工作经验，教育学专业同学可以关注后续发布的相关信息和公告。第六个，西安邮电大学非全日制 MPA 招生调剂咨询通道开启，报考条件里的工作经历时间需要留意，看一下自己是否符合相关条件，这些专业的管理学专硕的考生都有报考资格，大家可以参考这里给出的近3年 MPA 国家线，有在线咨询和电话咨询两种方式，有意向的小伙伴们可以联系。第七个，上海工程技术大学化学化工学院医药前沿技术研究院招收研究生，公布了30个名额，药学、化学、生物学、医学等相关专业都满足专业要求。下面是它的相关简介、学校政策和联系方式，同学们可以暂停查看。第八个，还是上海工程技术大学门勇教授的课题组发布的招收专业化学工程与技术的工业催化专业，招生人数为4人，调剂要求这里要数学、英语和政治达到1区国家线，感兴趣的同学可以发送自己的初试信息和个人简历。第九个，上海海洋大学接收调剂研究生，招收专业为植物学，招生人数1人，下面还补充了是上海海洋大学和上海农科院联合培养，分数要求340加，是胚胎工程课题组，所以需要生物学相关专业。第十个，黑龙江大学张国课题组发布，招收专业为化学工程，招生人数为2人，要求本科为化学相关专业，考数二，英语过6级优先，有调剂意向的同学可以邮箱联系。以上就是本期视频的全部内容了，想要获取更多考研调剂信息，不妨三连加关注。
1. What can you tell me about your hometown? I am from Kunming. First of all, Kunming is located in the central area of Yunnan, where the climate is pleasant. So it is also called Spring City. Secondly, people of more than 20 nationalities live in Kunming. The people in my hometown are hospitable and good at singing and dancing. Thirdly, it has a long history and many places of interest, such as Tianchi Lake, Snow Mountain, and so on. The ancestors of people in Kunming lived here tens of thousands of years ago. Finally, there are fungi, camellia, and many kinds of snacks. I love my hometown. Welcome to Kunming.
Could you tell us more details about your family? There are three people in my family, my parents and me. My father is a math teacher whose rigorous attitude towards life and teaching has been influencing me all the time. Although he was busy with his work when I was young and could not accompany me to grow up, but he sees every opportunity to tell me the truth of life. My mother is a kind-hearted and a diligent housewife, although she was not well-educated, but she has always stressed the importance of education. My parents give me enough respect, and my family atmosphere is harmonious. I am more than grateful to my parents.
Why did you choose to attend the postgraduate entrance examination? There are mainly three reasons. Firstly, electric power is an important material basis for developing production and improving human living standards. I am very interested in electrical engineering and eager to make contributions to its development. Secondly, in the past 4 years of study, I have deeply realized my shortcomings in theory and practice, so I want to seek more practical opportunities and improve my abilities in all aspects through further study. Thirdly, your school is my dream school with excellent faculty and a strong academic atmosphere. I believe I can realize my dream here.
Did you make a plan for your postgraduate study? If I am lucky enough to be admitted, I will cherish this opportunity. I would lay a solid knowledge foundation and improve my ability in all aspects. And if possible, I will pursue a PhD. In the first year, I will take each course seriously. In addition, I also need to read more related articles to get familiar with the tutor's research content as soon as possible and consolidate the knowledge foundation and form a systematic view of knowledge. In the second year, I will continue to do experiments seriously. I want to actively participate in the projects of my tutor to constantly enrich my understanding of theoretical knowledge and improve my practical ability. I am also supposed to collect materials for my dissertation and articles and determine the topic and outline. In the third year, I will insist on promoting the writing of my dissertation and get ready for further study. I sincerely hope I can make my dream come true in your university.
1. What do you think makes you different from other applicants of this postgraduate program? Everyone has their own characteristics, and other candidates must have their own strength to make them pass the postgraduate entrance examination. I am an optimistic and a cheerful person. In the face of adversity, I will not be easily hit by the difficulties, but regarding them as opportunities to make progress. Therefore, I believe that I can keep a positive attitude and face new challenges in the future postgraduate life. Second, what do you usually do to cheer yourself up? When I feel down, I usually go jogging to adjust myself. After I calm down, I will seriously think about and summarize the reasons to avoid similar things.
3. Can you share with us a habit in learning English?
To tell the truth, my English is not very good, especially my oral English. In order to improve my oral English, I have been talking with my friends in English every day since the junior year, and now I have got much better in it. 4. What kinds of people do you find it difficult to work with? People who don't respect others, whether in life or in business, are difficult to get along with because respect is a prerequisite for a good relationship. 5. What are the things you find difficult to do? I think it's very difficult to stick to one thing, which requires great self-control and perseverance. I think I am a person of perseverance. I have never been defeated by all kinds of difficulties when preparing for the postgraduate entrance examination. 6. What's your definition of success?Success is not just about gaining fame or accumulating wealth. It's about achieving one's dreams through hard work and persistence. The sense of accomplishment that comes with realizing your dreams is what defines success. 7. Tell me about a time when your course load was heavy. How did you get all of your work done? When facing a lot of tasks, I don't take them negatively. First of all, I will listthe tasks according to their urgency, then I will arrange the time needed to complete each task. When I do the tasks, I will improve my efficiency and finish them within the stipulated time. I really like being organized. 8. How do you handle with rejection? To say no is a right that everyone has. Sometimes we may be embarrassed to refuseThe unreasonable request of others. In this case, we should realize the impact of not refusing on ourselves and stick to our own principles. Sometimes we may be mercilessly rejected by others, in which case it's necessary to consider whether there is a problem in ideas or the way we speak, etc. Interests and hobbies. 9. What's your hobby? I like reading books, which can broaden our horizon and help us establish correct values. I also feel relaxed when I am immersed in the words of a book. 10. What's your favorite animal? Why? I like cats because they are relatively quiet but interesting animals and can provide companion and spiritual comfort. 11. What's your favorite movie?My favorite movie is Forrest Gump. Forrest Gump, a small town boy born with intellectual disabilities, perseveres and eventually gets God's blessing and creates miracles in a number of fields. Opportunities are always left to those who are prepared, and we should be positive and firm in the face of hardship in life. Families and friends. 12. Do you have a brother or sister?Yes, I have a younger brother. He's a senior high school student. He likes playing basketball and running, and occasionally listens to music to kill time. We have a lot in common, so we have a good relationship. Sometimes I can learn a lot from him. 13. How do you handle with conflicts with others?First of all, we should recognize the nature of conflict. Conflicts lie in differences, and we should treat the differences in each person's personality or point of view with respect. Secondly, when there is a conflict, we should actively communicate in an effective way and exchange each other's ideas to clear up the misunderstanding. Places. 14.Will you work at your hometown? Yes, I definitely will. First of all, I'm from Tai'an. My hometown is the place I am most familiar with. I have been used to the pace of life and a comfortable environment here. If I can find a dream job in such a situation, it must be really the best thing.Secondly, I also hope to improve my ability and make some contribution to the construction of my hometown through my own efforts. Studies and research. 15. How can you improve your ability in postgraduate study? First, I will set several goals to guide me to make continuous progress. Secondly, I will pay more attention to the accumulation of basic knowledge and take every class seriously. In addition, I will actively participate in research and social practice activities to improve myself in practice. I sincerely hope that my professional ability, practical ability, and teamwork ability can be improved during the postgraduate period. 16. What has been your greatest achievements? My greatest achievement is that I once led a team to participate in a social practice and then won the second prize through my leadership and our joint efforts. In the process, I have deepened my understanding of teamwork. 17. What kind of opportunities do you want?I have many deficiencies in English and professional knowledge, so I hope to make use of the large platform of the school to improve myself. Opportunities are always left to those who are prepared. I will be strict with myself and seize any opportunity that can be seized. Graduate School, 18. Why didn't you pass CT4?During my undergraduate period, I did not realize the importance of English and was not fully prepared for the exam, which led to my failure in CET4. But if I am lucky enough to be admitted, I will focus on improving my English reading ability and try my best to pass CET4 and CET6 in the first year. 19. What do you do when you disagree with your supervisor during postgraduate study?First, I will find out the reasons for the disagreement by searching relevant materials and try to reconsider the problem from the teacher's point of view. Secondly, I will actively communicate with the teacher and exchange opinions. If we cannot reach an agreement, I will take the initiative to ask the teacher for advice. Future, 20.How to finish your dissertation successfully? First, I need to strengthen my professional knowledge base from the very beginning. Secondly, I will read articles efficiently to do background research and determine my general research direction. Then I will ask teachers for advice. Thirdly, after determining the topic, I will continue to read related articles and then keep moving forward every day. Finally, I will sort out the full text and improve the details. I also need to prepare for the graduation thesis defense. 1. Are you a happy person?Yes, of course, I am a happy person. Life has given me a lot of moves and surprises with love to fill my life. I have lovely parents and like-minded friends. I have also made some achievements in my study and life. I am very grateful for what fate has brought me. Second, what's your opinion on failure? Failure is not to be feared.What's feared is the failure to face it and learn from it. Failure is the mother of success, and we cannot be defeated by a failure. What we are supposed to do is to try to find the reason of failure, keep high morale, and achieve new progress. 3. What do you think of extreme sports?I am prudent and dare not do extreme sports, especially in recent years. More and more people have lost their life when doing extreme sports, which only intensified my fear. Maybe some people think that people who participate in extreme sports are brave and cool, but it's dangerous and I can't accept it. 4. What do you think of people with ambition?Ambition is the driving force in people's progress. Ambitious people may think about how to improve themselves and achieve their goals. But if one attaches too much importance to ambition but ignores legal and moral constraints, he may cause harm to society and others in the process of pursuing his dream. 5. Is it always good to be ambitious?We need to look at ambition dialectically. For some, ambition can be a motivator for progress. But some people blinded by ambition will stop moving forward and even do something harmful to society. 6. Has cell phone changed your life in any way?With the progress of science and technology, the innovation of mobile phone is getting faster and faster. We can get information and news at home and abroad faster through mobile phones. But on the other hand, we are increasingly dependent on mobile phones, which may make us neglect the family and friends around us and affect the relationship. Interests and hobbies. 7. What's your favorite color? My favorite color is green, which represents life and hope. In spring, green is everywhere, which can relax our eyes. So in spring, I like going for walks in the field. 8. Do you prefer traveling by car or by train? I prefer traveling by car. It's convenient to travel by car because we can stop at any time and go wherever we want without time limit. We also can carry many luggage in the car. If we like the scenery somewhere, we can stop to take pictures. In a world, traveling by car is more convenient. 9. Do you like surprise? Yes, I do like surprises. Because the person who prepared the surprise has paid out his or her consideration, and surprises also add color and passion to ordinary days. Family and friends. 10. Could you please tell us more details about your mother? My mother is a diligent and a kind housewife. She respects my ideas very much. Although she didn't read many books, she always stressed the importance of knowledge to me and always encouraged me to move forward when I was young. 11. Do you think it easy to make friends with others? It's not that easy to make friends with others because a good relationship needs more care. The care between friends nourishes the flower of friendship. So it may be easy to establish a new friendship, but hard to maintain it. 12. How would you describe a good friendship? Good friendship is built on mutual respect. Good friendship is sometimes the driving force to push each other forward. Even if they don't see each other very often, they will always care about each other. Family and friends. 13. Is it important for people to have good relationships with their colleagues at work? Yes, absolutely important. First, building a friendly relationship with colleagues can help understand and help each other in work. Good interpersonal relationship and a working atmosphere can make people finish work more efficiently. Then, building good friendships helps to relieve the stress we encounter at work and makes us healthier both physically and mentally. Places. 14. Do you think walking in the countryside is better than walking in the city? I prefer walking in the countryside. First, the air in the countryside is much more fresh, and one can really immerse himself in nature. Second, there are fewer cars in the countryside, which provides a safer place for people. 15. Do you like the library in your undergraduate school? I really like the library in my undergraduate period. First, although the library is old, it holds a large amount of books, and I can find almost any books I need in it. Second, there are many students studying in the library. The first floor of the library is a very modern cafe. The rigorous attitude of the students studying in the library has always inspired me to move forward. Studies and research. 16. Are you good at time management? I'm good at time management. It's important to properly set our schedule, and I usually sort the tasks according to urgency, and then I improve my efficiency in the process of completing the tasks and stick to the plan. This avoids the waste of time, and orderly arrangement makes me more energetic in study and work. 17. Do you think planning is important for time management? Planning is definitely important for time management and even the core of it. First, without a plan, we tend to fall back into disorganized patterns. and unable to break out of ourselves. Second, without a plan, we tend to make impulsive efforts and can't stick in the long run. So if we want to carry out time management, planning is the first and most important step. Graduate school 18. What will you do if you're facing difficulties in the 3 years? Life is full of challenges and difficulties. When facing difficulties, I would try my best to find out a solution. If it is too hard for me, I would ask someone for help. 19. Do you want to acquire new skills or abilities during postgraduate years? I'm eager to improve myself in the following 3 aspects. First, I want to improve my English. During the undergraduate years, there was not too much opportunities for me to use English either in speaking or in reading. But in postgraduate study, it's urgent for me to do well in reading English articles. Second, I want to improve my communication skill. Effective communication promotes efficient study and work. Third, initiative learning ability. Postgraduate study needs more initiative to consolidate the knowledge base and broaden the horizon. Future 20. What will you do to prepare for your future career? If I am lucky enough to be admitted, I would cherish this opportunity. First of all, I will set goals and correctly understand my shortcomings. I'd like to take each class seriously and read more relevant articles in my spare time, which will help broaden my scope of knowledge and form a systematic view of knowledge. Secondly, I will take an active part in projects and experiments, constantly deepening my understanding of knowledge and better combining theory with practice. Finally, I will actively participate in social practice in order to make more contributions to the society and improve my social practice ability to better adapt to the society. 1. Do you prefer watching films at the cinema or at home? I prefer watching films at home because the atmosphere at home is much more comfortable and I can laugh freely when I see funny thing. 2. What do you think of the differences between different people? No two lives in the world are exactly the same. We should respect the differences. This is what makes everyone special. Respect for differences is the promise of getting along with each other. 3. Have you made a mistake? Yes, of course. Nobody is perfect. I once lied to my mother, and later my mother found out and criticized me severely. From then on, I have made up my mind to be an honest man. 4. Do you prefer traveling on your own or with your friends? I definitely prefer traveling with my friends because it's really a fantastic way to entertain and promote friendship. When I travel on my own, I may feel a little bit lonely, but with my friends, I can have much fun and feel safer. 5. Do you think it's important to be on time? Yeah, I think it definitely is. Being on time is a basic manner in daily life. It's implied to let others wait for a long time, so we must be on time when we have a date with others.
And hobbies. 6. Do you like reading newspapers? No, I don't really read newspapers that much. Because of the development of technology, we can go through news with our cell phones, which is more convenient. 7. Are you very interested in art? Yes, I am. I always enjoy looking at creative paintings and try to find and record the beautiful moments in our life by using camera. 8. Is interest important for students? Yeah, interest is the best teacher. Interest can stimulate our enthusiasm to do something, push us to solve the problems, and keep us moving forward. So when choosing major and future occupation, interest is also an important reference. 9. Do you like cooking?Yes, I enjoy it. I am very good at cooking. In my spare time at home, I often prepare lunch and dinner for my family. Their satisfactory smile gives me a sense of achievement. I enjoy cooking, which is a good way to help my mother and reduce her burden. Family and friends. 10. How did your father influence you?My father is a serious but warm-hearted man. He has been very strict with me since I was young. No matter in study or life, he would point out my mistakes directly and supervise me to correct them. He also taught me a lot of truth with his own experience. So it's my father who has gradually made me who I am today. 11. What does your family usually do on holidays? The holidays are very precious for us to get together. Sometimes my father will take us out for a visit, especially to some tourist attractions with rich historical heritage. Sometimes we just stay at home. My father likes watching movies. My mother usually tends her flowers and plants or go shopping. I'd like to read and play basketball to kill time. Places. 12. If I have only half a day to spare in your hometown, where do you suggest me to go? I come from Tai'an. I recommend you to Dai Temple. There are ancient buildings where ancient emperors worshipped. Even every tree and grass, as well as the buildings and the calligraphy and the paintings, can allow you to talk to ancient figures. Wish you a good time. 13. What's the best place you have ever been to? Why? I have been to Nanjing. Nanjing is one of the important birthplaces of Chinese civilization. There are many beautiful scenery and places of interest. When you walk on the streets, it seems like stepping through history to get there.
Studies and research. 14. Which kind of professor do you like most? I like teachers.Who can give me advice when I am trapped in troubles and lead me into a world full of professional knowledge. In addition, personality is also a key factor. 15. What professional knowledge have you learned at your university? During my 4-year study, I have acquired plenty of knowledge of control science and engineering and electrical engineering. The more I learn, the more I know that I need to learn. Have realized the deficiencies in knowledge. I think that further study in this field is urgent for me. 16. How do you plan to improve your English?English is definitely important in our life, which is the key to learning about the outside world. Postgraduate students need to read English articles. If one's English ability is poor, it will affect the acquisition of advanced knowledge, thus affecting his whole learning process. So I have to improve my English. I plan to choose some English articles in this field to improve my reading ability. I also need more dialogue practice to improve my spoken English. Studies and research. 17. How do you feel about your achievement so far? I think I definitely did a well job during my undergraduate period. I took my courses seriously and won scholarships for 3 times. But the past is just the past, and I will continue to make greater progress under the inspiration of my perceived achievements. Graduate school. 18. What do you want to acquire through postgraduate study? First, I'm eager to acquire more advanced knowledge of electric engineering through courses. Second, I want to improve my communication skills and cooperation abilities through working and studying with others. Third, I'd like to exchange ideas with others to deepen my understanding of this field and broaden my horizon. 19. Do you have any idea of pursuing a PhD? If given the opportunity, I would definitely choose to pursue a PhD. First, in order to be a qualified doctor, 3 years of postgraduate study may not be enough for me to fully grasp all the knowledge about diabetes. Second, I have been looking forward to producing some achievements in this field, so I would participate actively in projects and researches to better combine theories with practice and strive to help teachers break through the difficulties in this field. Future 20. What's your dream job? I enjoy being with young students and a comfortable atmosphere in university, so I want to be a lecturer in university. First, the working environment in university is relatively relaxing and the teachers do not have to face too much pressure. Second, I want to pass on what I have learned to students, make new progress in this field, and cultivate talents for our country. But I know that this is not very easy and I still have a long way to go. Yourself. 1. What's your biggest weakness? To be honest, I lack self-confidence. When I explain my ideas in front of others, I would inevitably get nervous, as I have realized that it would hinder my progress. I'm trying my best to seize any opportunities to deliver a speech in front of others. Thank you. 2. What's your biggest strength? I think my positive attitude towards life is my biggest strength. The difficulties and the challenges in my life, if not dealt with properly, will prevent us from moving forward. But I regard them as a kind of way to improve myself. No matter how difficult the problem is, I'd like to be 100% committed to solving it, which brings me a sense of accomplishment.
3. Can you use an example to show your team spirit? Okay, during my undergraduate years, there were many activities that required teamwork. In a summer social practice, 10 of us did our work according to the division of labor and tried our best to solve problems together. Finally, we completed the task smoothly, which deepened my understanding of teamwork. And I think I've always been a person with team spirit. 4. Introduce your college. I will graduate from Shandong University. I cherish the beautiful scenery and the library there. The beautiful scenery always make me feel at ease. In the library, hardworking students bury themselves in reading, which encourages me to keep moving. I'm also grateful to the students who have led us to a bigger and a brighter future. 5. What's your major? How do you like it? I major in clinical medicine. When I saw my family suffering from kinds of diseases, I always blamed myself for not being able to ease their pain. Clinical medicine is a major in which one can combine theory with practice and find more effective cure for patients, and then gain a strong sense of responsibility and accomplishment. So I want to further my study to make more contributions. 6. If you fail this time, what will you do in the near future? If I fail this time, I would first reflect on myself and find out reasons. Nobody is perfect. I must face up to my shortcomings and try my best to make up for them. But I am a girl of perseverance, Then I'd like to keep making progress in study and improving my abilities until my dream comes true. 7. What do you usually do in your spare time? I like reading books when I am free. Books lead me into a world full of knowledge that cannot be acquired from normal classes. Reading gives me the opportunity to learn about the outside world and broaden my horizon. 8. What's your favorite sport? I like jogging. Jogging helps me release my pressure and it gives me a healthier body. Because of jogging, I also met a lot of like-minded friends. 9. Who is your idol? Why? My idol is Kobe Bryant. He is the spokesman of the Mamba mentality, which means never give up. As my spiritual motivation, although he has passed away, his unyielding spirit has always inspired me. Family and friends. 10. Can you tell me more details about your family? Okay, there are 3 people in my family, my parents and me. My father is a math teacher whose rigorous attitude towards life and the teaching has been influencing me all the time. My mother is a kind-hearted and diligent housewife. My parents give me enough respect, and my family atmosphere is harmonious. I am more than grateful to my parents. 11. Describe your best friend. My best friend is Chen Xi. He is very considerate and helpful. He offered me a lot of help when we were growing up together. Although there were some conflicts between us, we solved them properly in the end. Places. 12. Could you tell us more details about your hometown? I come from Tai'an, a city famous for Mount Tai. It's located in the middle of Shandong province. There are many other tourist attractions. The people there are friendly and hospitable. Welcome to Tai'an. 13. Do you prefer to live in the city or the countryside? I prefer to live in the countryside. Since I was young, I have been living in the countryside for more than 20 years. I've got used to the slow pace and the ease of countryside life. Moreover, life in the countryside is not so crowded and stressful as that in the city. That's all for my reason. 14. Do you like traveling? Why or why not? Yes, I really enjoy traveling. First, the beautiful scenery and the delicious food in the journey make me relax and enjoy myself. Then, through traveling, I can experience different customs in different places and acquire knowledge not presented in books, which broadens my horizon. Studies and research. 15. Why do you think your school gives you the Merit Student Scholarship? During my undergraduate years, I've been working hard all the time. I took my courses seriously and achieved good results. In addition, I took an active part in various activities held by school to enrich my spare time and social experience. I'm also a helpful and considerate person. Generally speaking, I am a well-rounded person. 16. Why did you choose to go to graduate school instead of working? First of all, I recognized my great interest in clinical medicine and wanted to make some contributions to its development in the future. In addition, I thought I had many deficiencies in professional knowledge and relevant abilities. In order to improve myself, I chose to further my study. 17. Should a student study more theory or do more practice? Both of them are important. As a student, we should use theory to guide our practice and constantly deepen our understanding of the theory through practice. Graduate school. 18. Why did you choose this university? Firstly, I am deeply attracted by the strong academic atmosphere in this university. Secondly, I think the professional teaching staff and the achievements you have made in recent years will give me more opportunities for progress. 19. Why did you choose to pursue a master's degree? There are several reasons. First, I really want to be a lecturer in the future, but I realize that there are shortcomings and deficiencies in my professional knowledge and abilities, so I chose to further my study. Second, the strong academic atmosphere and the professional teaching staff in your school make me believe that I can make great progress under your guidance. In a word, I'm looking forward to building a solid foundation for future profession after 3 years study here. Future 20. Did you make a plan for your postgraduate study? If I am lucky enough to be admitted, I will take the study and the research in this field seriously. First, I will work hard to acquire theoretical knowledge, constructing a solid base for my future work. Second, I'd like to take an active part in some projects and researches in this field to better combine theories with practice. Third, I will actively read more relevant articles and issue my own theoretical achievements under the guidance of my teacher. I believe that where there is a will, there is a way. My dream will finally come true after my hard work.
救命啊，家人们，怎么还有人不知道怎么找调剂信息，怎么看一个学校有没有调剂名额啊？我以前视频里讲过，大家可以直接去翻，我这里给你们现场演示一遍，你一定要记住了，收藏起来这个视频，或者分享给你找不着调剂信息的朋友，省得自己找的时候又抓瞎。首先，找调剂信息啊，有两个官方渠道，第一个，研招网。大家直接那点进来，进首页，有两个地方可以看到调剂信息，第一个是什么呢？直接在首页你拉到最下面，你看信息发布这里招生单位啊，我们随便点开一个，比如说西安电子工程这个研究所啊，它上面写的是考试初试成绩复核办法，但是咱们往下拉，它写了一个啥呢？我单位第一志愿生源不满，接受调剂咨询，可以把你这些东西发到这个邮箱啊，然后说啊复试方案呀、调剂政策呀，这个之后会根据具体情况来发布。就你看，这不就是一个就是调剂信息嘛？就很多研究所啊研究院啊，他经常就是在研招网上这么发公告的。第二个地方，看上面这一栏网上调剂看到了没有，点进去啊，现在他这个调剂系统还没开啊，但是有一些打广告的已经有了啊，咱们拉到最后，调剂信息看到了没有，查看更多，这里面都是往年的调剂信息是有的，今年呢还没有开始更新汇总，啥时候更呢？国家线下来以后啊，每年都是这样的。那么就是除了研招网，就是现在很多的官方调剂信息，就我经常带大家看的那种，都是哪儿来的呢？这就是调剂信息的另一个官方渠道，院校官网啊。这里我强调一下，大家不要去啊学校的那个大的总的官网啊，你要去各个学院官网看，一般都是各个学院单独在自己的学院官网或研究生院官网上发。再一个就是各个学院的那个官微也会发调剂信息的，我给你演示一下哦，就院校官网吧。咱们看这个，就我经常提的发的特别早的那个陕西理工大学啊物理与电信工程学院，我们看它啊，点进去然后找，直接找通知公告，一般要不然是在这个通知公告里，要不然就是在研究生教育相关的地方。咱们看第一条信息，这不就是它的预调剂公告吗？看看时间，人家1月5号就发了啊。然后咱们啊，你们真的应该经常就是咱们弹幕啊评论区留一下言，跟我互动一下，说说你们的困惑。就1月5号我就带你们看了这个信息，然后现在还有同学跟我说找不着调剂信息，就这个就不应该啊，你们早点说，我早点就录这个视频了啊。官微的话，就是咱们直接打开微信，点一下搜索的图标，微信里面咱们直接搜一个，咱们还是搜这个陕西理工大学啊，人文学院研究生啊，就是学校加学院加研究生，有时再加个调剂，一般你在微信里组合输入这几个关键词就可以比较准确的找到信息了啊。顺便说一句啊，一个学校不同学院发调剂信息的时间可能不一样啊，像这个陕西理工大学它这个
物理与电信工程学院1月5号就发了，但是它人文学院就近期才发的。所以呢，你专业对应学院是什么，你直接去看它的官网或者官微学院官网啊，以及如果一个学校某个学院发了调剂公告，通常其他学院也会陆续发的，这是个小规律，大家记一下。如果院校今年还没有发调剂信息，你想知道它今年会不会招调剂怎么办呢？去官网翻以前的调剂公告演示一下啊，我给你们。咱们就看一个兰州大学吧，兰州大学的土木工程与力学学院，第一个就是啊，咱们点进去看，还是就是一般啊，它不是在通知公告里面，就是在什么啊，硕士研究生教育里头。这个我们看研究硕士招生这块啊，然后咱们点还是硕士教育嘛，就是硕士教育这一块，你就直接看到这个页面了。然后你一看啊，22的它的逆录取呀，啊一志愿上线名单，这不都有吗？那咱们先看一下一志愿上线名单，我点这个主要是给大家看一下他们的学校编码，一般咱们考生编号的前五位就是这个学校的啊学校代码10730，这个就应该是兰大的学校代码了。那接下来咱们看一下逆录取的名单啊，就看一个这个，我们看一下它的土木工程吧。那10730刚刚咱们看了是兰大的学校代码，那现在后面这10533啊10213这些都是啥呀，那就都是调剂生源呀，因为他们就是这个考生编号前五位，它是代表着你一志愿的院校嘛，那这些肯定都是调剂过来的啊。咱们看啊，这是20个录取的，看一下他们的最低分啊，有312的这个同学啊也是录取了，我们看一下他哪个学校来的啊，10286或东南大学，还有一个啊，这有个318录取的，10613，我们看一下是哪个学校啊，西南交通大学。所以啊，就你要是今年分数也是差不多这个档次啊，本科也不错，那你调剂兰大土木就是有希望的。总之你搜目标院校目标专业所在的学院，看往年的逆录取名单，你用查院校编号的一个方法，不仅可以知道他以前接不接受调剂，数出来他的调剂名额，甚至能直接搜出来他的调剂生源从哪儿来，这样你就能根据他的生源情况对比分析出来自己适不适合这所学校，调剂的希望大不大。大家一定要把我这期视频收藏起来，找调剂你直接照着我的操作方法来就行了，就赶紧行动起来。现在咱们离出国家线越来越近了嘛，很多院校也开始陆续发官方信息了，你要是还是觉得自己找起来有困难，就关注我啊，一键三连，各种调剂信息啊，调剂窍门这种的，我都会及时跟大家分享的。你上岸准备复试，准备调剂，就会轻松很多了。艺术类考生想上岸，不管调剂还是一志愿，一定要看这期视频。这是我们牛哥考研艺术团队的老师们专门写的一份攻略，带艺术调剂的几个老师根据过往数百个学生的调剂案例总结出来的，你可能找不到讲得更透的视频了。首先介绍一下艺术大类所涉及到的专业，包含1301艺术学理论，1302音乐与舞蹈学，1303戏剧与影视学，1304美术学，1305设计学，这一系列学硕，以及1351下面的各个专硕方向，包括像艺术啊、音乐、戏剧、戏曲、电影、广播电视、舞蹈、美术、艺术设计等等啊。因为各个方向情况不一，非常复杂，以及视频内容实在有限，我们重点聊聊最常被问的几个代码。首先是1301的艺术学理论，近三年未出现非全日制的调剂院校，出现调剂的院校数量较少，名额也少。考生你直接根据自己的分数、专业课类型提前锁定院校就好，因为这些院校的调剂招生名额过少嘛，它无法按照分数我去给你们推荐院校的。其次是1302音乐与舞蹈学，有些学校与学院招收调剂考生它是不区分方向的，有些呢它是有明确方向规定的，就是如果是明确音乐方向或者明确舞蹈方向的，就算同属于一三大类也是不能相互调剂的。举个例子啊，有些学校它的调剂方向是笛子演奏，在此方向上未有涉猎的同学可以放弃考虑这种院校，如果有涉猎的同学，那你就啊把它放进自己的备注框进行详细备注，争取进入啊复试的名额。接下来是1303戏剧与影视学方向的考生，可以着重关注往年调剂名额较多的院校，我这里点几个啊。2021年山西师范大学戏剧与影视共招收36名调剂考生，22年福建师范招收20名考生。从录取分数上来看，就是即使国家线上下的同学也是有机会的，但每年的调剂都是变化的动态的。例如山西师范22年他就没招收调剂考生，这种情况呢一般是以下原因导致的。一，前一年调剂名额太多，导致部分学生认为该校比较容易上岸，第二年一志愿直接爆满。 二、当年扩招，第二年恢复招生。三、部分院校调整硕士点。这些情况都需要与研招办进行核实，然后再看这所高校能不能纳入你的选择范围。1304，美术学校设方向也比较多，包括中国画、油画、雕塑艺术、插画、公共艺术、美术、文产研究、书法等等。大家调剂的时候仍是优先选择本方向的学校进行定点跟踪。其次，调剂生源的一志愿来源你也要分析一下，看看该院校是否偏向于报考志愿是经过学科评估的学生。这里送大家两点调剂小技巧啊。第一，艺术学理论的同学如果分数过低，可以往美术学进行调剂，但是研究方向不能相差太大。第二，分数不高的同学可以考虑非全的硕士进行攻读，或者在填写志愿时啊给那个非全留一个位置，这样不至于你一个复试通知都收不到。对于1351的同学来说啊，即使前四位代码相同，也不能完全根据前四位代码来进行调剂。就部分院校它明确规定的该专业的调剂是要本科在一定学科范围内的同学才可以进行调啊，有些要求较为严格的院校会要求学生本科或者填报的志愿要经过学科评估。学科评估呢，是教育部学位与研究生教育发展中心按照国务院学位委员会和中华人民共和国教育部颁布的啊，这个学位授予和人才培养学科目录，对具有博士、硕士学位授予权的一级学科进行整体水平的评估啊。它对前70%的学科分了九档公布，就是 A 加呀、A 减、B 加、B 减、C 加、C 减，就是你要对自己的本科院校水平或者报考志愿的院校学科评估不太清楚的，你先去看一下它到底是什么评级，以防你后面做的都是无用功。大家注意，1351调剂有一个潜规则，就是部分院校会要求学生本科或一志愿是要经过学科评估的，否则不发复试通知。因此大家你要提前了解好啊，你这个学科评级。1351下设的各个专硕代码的调剂情况与学硕是类似的啊，以135101音乐为例，各个院校的缺额它也是有具体的方向的嘛，就部分专业其实是无法互通的。像我们老师之前就是带艺术调剂的团队里面啊，带过一个古琴方向的很有造诣而且名声很好的一个音乐家，因为各种不可抗力他需要调剂，虽然成功进入某高校非古琴类的复试，但在复试现场老师明确提出不接受跨专业方向的调剂，因为是线上面试才少了些折腾，要是线下复试的话恐怕得白跑一趟。就虽然学校的做法大家可以理解，但对考生来说是比较残忍的，所以我们的艺术类调剂团队的老师们建议啊，集体建议大家一定要先看准方向然后有的放矢。135102的学生也是如此，就历年来戏剧的调剂院校寥寥无几，你们最好提前打探好院校的信息进行准备。复试方面，首先根据老师们往年带艺术大类调剂和复试的经验来看，对于艺术类考生来说，英语复试可能存在比较大的问题。就英语常有两部分构成，第一部分英文自我介绍，这部分咱们只要提前准备好，然后每天背一背，背熟就可以了。还有一部分是常见问答，就是常见的英语问题，比如介绍你的家乡啊，你的兴趣爱好是什么。部分层次高一些的院校会问专业相关的外语问题，以武汉大学为例，该院校对学生英语的考察不是简单的常见问题，会问得很专业，比如他们的电影学，它就会涉及到流派风格和对某个导演作品的看法。因此我们需要按照目标院校的复试情况进行针对性的准备。另外今年大概率恢复线下复试，不排除部分院校会进行一些听力考察，那作为调剂考生我们应当进行较为全面的准备，但也应当根据各科目的占比去合理分配时间。比如英语顶多复试占比 20%， 那你就不要花太多时间复习英语了，这就需要巧劲儿啊！教大家一个英语复习的方法，就是一志愿考生也适用，就你不要一个问题背一个模板，而是要想办法用一个答案可以回答好多种问题，然后把这个答案背下来。专业课方面，由于艺术生的复试科目种类实在繁多，就是我视频里没法一个一个给你们讲，有需求可以进一步后台咨询，我提一个问的很多的点作品集。部分同学的初试科目会考察手绘，这种肯定是要提前准备作品集的，部分院校也会在复试开始之前收集同学们的作品集，并且以此作为是否给考生发放复试通知的依据。我转达一下带艺术调剂的几个老师的建议啊，也是送大家一个彩蛋吧，就是关于咱们怎么准备作品集。就我们的作品集啊，应当有合理的逻辑线条，而不是单纯的将作品就是简单的放在一起就 OK。 这个逻辑线条是我们赋予作品的，比如某张大图的部分细节的放大，在四周以文字和图样形式进行简单介绍，或者以一个房屋建筑为例，你行走路线带来的视角切换，以及就是用图片加文字的形式你要进行一个简单的阐释。总之艺术类考生的调剂相对其他学科来讲特别难啊，专业方向太多了，而且每个专业方向它影响最终的上业结果的因素又各不相同，你没办法用分数去区分，最好就是具体问题具体分析。但这期视频呢，关于艺术调剂的干货仍然很多，可能是艺术调剂视频里最多的一个，因为很少有老师就是能把艺术调剂的规则掰扯这么清楚，只有我们团队的那些老师可以做到嘛。所以收藏起来，一键三连，关注我们，后续各种信息动态干货你都不会错过了。
大家好，我们是牛哥考研调剂团队，这一期给大家推荐西南地区的院校，含四川、重庆、贵州、云南、西藏等地。该信息主要参考往年调剂信息，今年大概率会有，建议收藏，感谢三连。校外调剂名额较少，要求较高，分数高且综合实力比较突出的考生可以关注。四川大学，校外调剂名额较少，要求较高，各方面实力比较突出的高分考生可以关注。四川农业大学，调剂名额较少，农林相关专业为主，有些专业会看调剂生的本科专业。西南农业大学，调剂名额不多，集中在医学、药学和化学等相关专业。西南石油大学，有一定调剂名额，工科为主，对调剂一志愿报考院校比较看重。成都中医药大学，调剂名额较少，双一流高校，要求较高，看重一志愿报考院校。四川师范大学，调剂名额较少，师范文史类专业在四川排名很靠前，分数不错的同学可以考虑。西南民族大学，调剂名额相对较多，各类型专业都有一定缺额，分数优势不大，想在成都学习读书的可以重点关注。成都信息工程大学，有一定调剂名额，工科很强，开放调剂的专业类型较多。西南科技大学，调剂名额较多，各类专业都有一定缺额，工科类专业名额较多。西南医科大学，有一定调剂名额，除医学类专业外，有少量文科、工科专业接受调剂。西华师范大学，有一定调剂名额，文理专业都有，生化环材类专业多一些。成都大学，调剂名额较多，值得关注，当地影响力不错，想去成都上学分数优势不大的考生值得考虑。西华大学，调剂专业名额较多，调剂门槛不高，分数优势不大的同学可以考虑。四川省社会科学院，文科专业为主，名额不多。重庆地区，重庆大学，调剂名额较少，调剂门槛较高，一志愿不错的高分选手重点关注。西南大学，调剂名额较多，理工类专业为主，门槛不低，综合实力突出的考生可以考虑。西南政法大学，调剂名额很少，政法类老牌院校，综合实力不错的考生可以关注。重庆医科大学，每年有一定调剂名额，医学生物类为主，医学类考生值得关注。重庆工商大学，每年有一定调剂名额，重庆唯一的财经类学校，经管类考生可以关注。重庆师范大学，每年有一定调剂名额，调剂专业不仅限于师范类，在当地的影响力和口碑还不错。重庆理工大学，调剂名额较多，各类型专业都有缺额，调剂生源普遍较好。重庆交通大学，调剂名额较多，当地认可度很高，交通类相关专业比较强势。重庆邮电大学，调剂名额少，理工类专业为主，位置环境都不错，认可度也高。贵州地区，贵州大学，每年都有较多调剂名额，理工类居多，偏向录取一志愿院校为双一流的高分考生。贵州财经大学，省内影响力较大，分数优势不大的财经类考生可以考虑。贵州中医药大学，调剂名额少，中医药相关专业的调剂为主，药学院的名额相对多一些。贵州民族大学，每年有少量专业开放调剂，门槛不高，分数竞争力不大的考生可以考虑。贵州师范大学，每年有少量调剂名额，开放调剂的专业类型较多，理工类专业也有教育特色。贵州医科大学，每年有一定调剂名额，集中在基础医学院、临床医学院和药学院，想在本省发展的医科生可以关注。遵义医科大学，每年有少量调剂名额，在当地名气很大，认可度高，愿意在本省发展的医科生重点关注。云南地区，云南大学，调剂名额专业较多，各学科门类均有调剂，调剂生源以一志愿报考985、211的学生居多，注意单科成绩要求。昆明理工大学，调剂名额较多，热门非热门专业都有，很多调剂生一志愿报考都是双一流及以上院校。云南师范大学，调剂名额较多，开放调剂的专业类型丰富，省重点师范大学，省内名气较大，门槛不低。云南财经大学，调剂名额较多，财经类调剂生重点关注。 云南农业大学每年有一定调剂名额，集中在农业理工类专业，省内农林类院校实力比较好，农学专业相关考生可以考虑。昆明医科大学每年有一定数量的调剂名额，云南省最大的高等医学院校，医科类调剂生重点关注。西南林业大学调剂名额较多，全国四大林业大学之一，地理位置较好，值得考虑。云南中医药大学每年有少量调剂名额，中药中医类相关专业多一些，分数一般的考生可以考虑。理大学名额超多，调剂专业类型丰富，分数一般同学可以考虑。云南民族大学调剂名额较多，文科类为主，省属重点大学，分数一般的调剂生可以考虑。西藏地区西藏大学调剂名额较多，各类专业都有，想保院校层次的考生可以关注。西藏民族大学调剂名额超多，文科类专业为主，分数没有优势，只想上岸的选手可以重点关注。想要获取更多考研调剂相关资讯，请持续关注牛哥考研调剂。大家好，我们是牛哥考研调剂团队，这一期给大家推荐华南地区的院校，含广东、广西、福建、海南等地。该信息主要参考往年调剂信息，今年大概率会有，建议收藏，感谢三连。广东地区中山大学调剂名额较少，且要求比较高，一般医学院或者相对冷门的专业会有缺额。华南理工大学每年有少量调剂名额，集中在材化专业，文科类专业较少。暨南大学每年有少量校外调剂名额，集中在附属医学院。华南师范大学调剂名额较多，专业覆盖文理工商，高分选手可以重点考虑。华南农业大学调剂名额整体上不多，集中在农学类专业，看重医志愿报考院校。南方科技大学调剂名额不多，理工类专业为主，计算机相关专业也有名额。深圳大学调剂名额较多，重点关注。一志愿学校普遍为985、211，想在大湾区就业的高分考生值得考虑。广州医科大学调剂名额较多，医学类专业为主，医科生调剂可以考虑，要多留意各个学院的公告。广东医科大学每年有少量专业招收调剂，名额较多，多关注附属医院的名额。广东财经大学名额较多，集中在财经法学专业，相关专业都有调剂。汕头大学调剂名额超多，各类专业基本都有调剂，对医志愿院校并不看重。南方医科大学调剂名额较多，医学相关专业为主，看重医志愿报考院校。广东工业大学名额较多，集中在理工类专业，也有少量文科专业，重点关注。广州大学名额较多，整体实力在上升，分数不高的同学可以重点考虑。广东金融学院金融专硕调剂名额超多，金融专硕考生值得考虑。广东省社会科学院名额较少，人文社科类专业可以重点关注各省社科院。广东海洋大学调剂名额较多，省重点卓越农林大学招收调剂的专业较多，优势专业也有缺额。东莞理工学院调剂名额不多，门槛也不高，分数不高只想上岸的同学值得考虑。青海音乐学院音乐类考生重点关注，一般音乐类的调剂不多，能去青海的要靠实力加运气。广西地区广西大学传说中的调剂小清华每年有大量调剂名额，以接收优质985、211调剂生源为主，综合实力强的高分选手重点关注。广西师范大学调剂名额较多，文科专业为主，医志愿院校分数都比较突出的选手可以重点关注。广西医科大学广西地区最强的医学类院校，调剂名额不多，医学生值得考虑。桂林电子科技大学调剂名额超多，理工类为主，机械类电子类专业很强，值得关注。南宁师范大学每年有一定调剂名额，省内比较认可的师范类高校，分数不突出的同学可以考虑。广西中医药大学每年有一定调剂名额，生源主要为各类中医药院校医学院的考生，成绩一般的考生可以关注。桂林理工大学调剂名额超多，省内知名度还可以，部分专业学科建设水平较高，分数优势不大的同学可以考虑。广西民族大学名额超多，各类专业都有缺口，实力一般只想上岸的同学可以关注。福建地区厦门大学每年会有一定的调剂名额，集中在医学院、药学院和物理学系，医志愿报考985的高分调剂考生重点关注。福州大学 调剂名额较多，理工类专业为主，要求较高，大多数调剂考生一志愿为双一流及以上院校。福建师范大学调剂名额较多，各类型专业都有，调剂门槛高，大部分调剂生一志愿为双一流院校。福州医科大学调剂名额较少，有一定门槛，调剂生大多数是一志愿是双一流或知名医学院校。福建农林大学调剂大户重点关注，省内以及农林类高校中名气很大，除农林类专业开放调剂外，也有少量文科专业开放调剂。华侨大学调剂名额很多，各类专业都有缺口，分数一般同学重点关注。集美大学调剂名额较少，在当地影响力大，强势专业偏冷门，分数不突出的同学值得选择。福建中医药大学名额较少，中医药专业为主，当地认可度高，调剂生源质量好。闽南师范大学每年有一定调剂名额，省内知名度较高，分数优势不大，但是想在福建读研的同学值得考虑。福建工程学院调剂名额较多，省内就业还可以，分数一般同学可以考虑。厦门理工学院名额较多，集中在理工类专业，分数优势不大的同学可以考虑。南地区海南大学调剂名额很少，调剂时院校层次放在第一位的考生可以关注。海南师范大学每年有少量调剂名额，调剂考生大多数一志愿报考师范类知名院校，个别专业有英语四六级方面的要求。海南热带海洋学院每年有少量调剂名额，分数一般，想去海南读书的同学可以考虑。想要获取更多考研调剂相关资讯，请持续关注牛哥考研调剂。大家好，我们是牛哥考研调剂团队，这期给大家推荐华中地区的院校，含河南、湖北、湖南、山东等地，该信息主要参考往年调剂信息，今年大概率会有，建议收藏，感谢三连，先看省流版。大学调剂名额超多，集中在工科类专业，要求较高，看重一志愿报考院校，高分选手可以留意。河南大学调剂名额较多，热门非热门专业都有，双一流高校，门槛比较高，调剂生一志愿报考院校多为双一流高校。河南师范大学调剂名额较多，省内认可度很高，接受调剂的专业类型较多，理工类专业为主。河南财经政法大学每年有一定的调剂名额，文科类为主，优势专业如法学、经管也有名额。河南理工大学调剂名额较多，材化类专业名额最多，文科类专业也有少量调剂。河南农业大学每年有一定的调剂名额，农林类专业名额多一些。河南工业大学每年有一定的调剂名额，发展迅速，省内口碑比较好，想要在郑州读研但是分数优势不大的同学可以考虑。新乡医学院每年有一定调剂名额，医学类、生物类的专业名额比较多，分数优势不大的同学可以考虑。中原工学院调剂名额较多，电子信息、纺织服装等优势专业也有调剂缺口，分数不高的同学可以考虑。湖北地区武汉大学在985中属于调剂名额相对多的院校，各类型专业都有缺额，高分考生可以重点关注。华中农业大学每年有一定数量的调剂名额，文科类专业调剂名额多一些，偏向一志愿院校为双一流的考生。武汉理工大学每年有较多调剂名额，重点关注。理工类专业名额居多，特别是交通相关的专业，看重一志愿报考院校。中国地质大学武汉调剂名额较多，重点关注。开放调剂的专业类型较多，生化环材相关名额最多，看重原报考院校。湖北大学调剂名额较多，材化土木名额最多，文科专业中教育经管相关的调剂名额多一些。海军工程大学每年有少量调剂名额，接收调剂的专业几乎都是理工科，电子信息、机械、能动等专业名额多一点。武汉工程大学调剂大户重点关注，各类型专业都有调剂缺额。三峡大学每年都有较多调剂名额，覆盖的专业也多，水利电力特色与优势比较明显，行业内有不错的影响力，分数优势不大的同学可以考虑。长江大学每年都有很多调剂名额，湖北省属高校中规模最大、学科门类较全的综合性大学，开调剂的专业以理工科为主，分数优势不大的同学可以考虑。湖北工业大学调剂名额较多，湖北小211生化环材相关专业的调剂名额最多。湖北省社会科学院每年有一定调剂名额， 想要在武汉读研的文科类专业考生重点关注。湖南地区国防科技大学校外调剂名额很少，通常调剂缺口出在基础学科上，门槛比较高。湘潭大学调剂名额超多，重点关注。双一流高校有计算湘军的口碑，看重一志愿报考院校。长沙理工大学调剂名额较多，在省内的名气比较大，除理工科外也有少量文科专业接受调剂，分数优势不大的学生可以考虑。湖南农业大学每年有一定调剂名额，农林类为主，在本地名气非常大，看重一志愿报考院校。湖南科技大学调剂名额较多，文理专业都有缺口，分数优势不大的同学可以考虑。南华大学调剂大户，接受调剂的专业非常多，当地名气还可以，分数不高的考生多关注。湖南中医药大学调剂名额较少，医学类为主，中医领域很有名的院校，不太看重一志愿院校。吉首大学每年有一定的调剂名额，文理专业都有，湘西地区最知名的大学，分数优势不大的同学值得考虑。湖南工商大学法学院的国际法学等专业招调剂，目前湖南财经类非常好的院校，发展潜力比较大，财经类考生重点关注。湖南工业大学每年有一定调剂名额，生化环材类专业为主，位于株洲，位置较好，分数不太理想的理工科学生可以考虑。中共湖南省委党校通常有少量调剂名额，文史哲类专业以及想要进入公务员系统的考生，调剂时可以考虑各地的省委党校。山东地区中国海洋大学每年会有一定的调剂名额，对原报考院校不是特别看重，高分选手重点关注。中国石油大学华东每年会有一定的调剂名额，热门非热门专业都有，比较看重一志愿报考院校，分数要求也比较高，各方面都比较突出的选手可以重点关注。青岛大学调剂大户重点关注，在省内的名气影响力较大，接受调剂的专业类型丰富，综合实力不错的学生值得考虑。山东科技大学调剂名额超多，重点关注，各类专业都有缺额，生化环材最多。山东师范大学有一定调剂名额，调剂专业不仅限于师范类，山东省内比较认可的师范类高校，比较看重一志愿报考院校。山东财经大学调剂名额较多，经管类调剂生重点关注，老牌财经院校当地影响力较大，经管语言类专业名额多一些。青岛科技大学调剂名额超多，各类专业都有缺额，生化环材最多，想要在青岛读书但是分数优势不大的同学可以考虑。济南大学名额较多，各类专业都有一定缺口，当地认可度高，理工类专业的名额较多。青岛理工大学每年会有一定的调剂名额，理工类专业为主，建筑土木类专业在山东省名列前茅，且一般都有调剂缺额，分数优势不大，但是想在青岛读研的同学值得考虑。中共山东省委党校通常会有少量调剂名额，文史哲类专业的考生调剂时可以考虑这个选项，特别是想要考公务员的，省委党校是一个不错的调剂选择。想要获取更多考研调剂相关资讯，请持续关注牛哥考研调剂。
稿子们看到了吧，34所不少都已经出了那个复试线了，各大院校一志愿复试马上开启，一志愿复试结束呢，差不多调剂系统就会开了，紧接着就是调剂考生填报志愿参加调剂复试。我们当然希望不论一志愿还是复试大家都能顺利上岸，但是每年上不了岸的学生其实才是多数啊。你可能也不清楚自己到底哪里做的不对就没学上了，所以今天我们还是顺着上岸之路的各个环节捋一下你可能犯的错误，这些都是咱们要谨记的一些血泪教训啊，因为他们是我们这边的老师从以前带的学生身上总结出来的。老话说得好，别人成功的经验听听就好，但别人失败的经验一定要认真听，反复听。先说两个今年客观上对大家影响比较大的因素。第一，像去年一样，一志愿基本复试完毕后才开系统，就会让很多一志愿复试淘汰下来的考生也加入调剂大军，导致竞争难度增大。第二，今年研招网告知调剂系统开放的时间特别早，3月10日国家线公布那天，研招网就一起说了什么时候开调剂系统，往年都是临近开系统才说，比如去年3月31号开意向征集，4月6号开正式系统，3月29号研招网才发公告通知大家马上开调剂系统了。这么做带来的影响呢，细心的同学可能已经感受到了，今年高校开预调剂的要比往年多，而且可能提前组织调剂考生复试，比如北物资他们已经这么干了，虽然他们每年都提前组织预调剂的复试，但是像今年这么早还是很罕见的，现在就已经有同学收到复试的那个邀请了嘛。这意味着没参加预调剂的同学很可能调剂系统没开就已经失去一部分机会了，所以我建议大家啊，有调剂有预调剂的，只要你不是特别抗拒都参加一下，保个底儿，别等他们后面调剂都收的差不多了，眼光变高了，你还没复试通知想屈尊辅救一下，结果发现那些你本来看不上的院校专业原来自己高攀不了。这个情况其实也是去年很多同学上不了岸的，
原因之一啊。比如去年有一些热门理工科的同学，电子信息的、电气的，调剂后期发现哪里都走不了，分太低了嘛，想着妥协一下去生化环材吧。那时候生化环材的眼光可刁得很，要求水涨船高。大家心里要有个数，今年考研的474万，全国高校加起来的录取名额应该是130万以内，竞争是蛮激烈的，前期抢不到机会，后期机会少了，竞争难度会加剧，所以你想跨调，一开始就奔着这个方向去啊。说完了政策的一些因素，我们接下来说调剂流程方面啊。为什么说调剂流程呢？因为一志愿的你们马上就剩复试了嘛，复试为什么被刷我们一会儿讲。而调剂考生因为多一个步骤，要填调剂系统拿到复试通知才能去复试，所以这个过程中还会有一点变数，主要看以下几点。第一，没有保底院校过分乐观，好学校大家都想去，但还是得脚踏实地，结合自身情况来考虑啊。你想去211及以上层次的院校，本科非211或者分不够高的慎重，特别是专硕的，好多院校每年就几个名额嘛，你的分数不能打，真的不要硬碰。分数不错有机会的话也可以冲，但一定要记住，调剂系统开了第一批三个志愿，你不能都是那种只有几个名额的院校，分低的同学你至少两个要保底的。第二，不了解院校情况盲目填报，就从国家院出来，大家看最新的调剂信息啊，打研招办电话，联系导师啊，其实就是在了解院校情况嘛，人家往年最低分多少，今年名额多少，你有没有机会，有没有科目的限制，哪个导师的方向跟你比较匹配，导师的名额是不是已经满了等等，这是明面上你必须要去了解的。还有更浅的一些层面的了解，比如对本科有没有偏好，医志愿有没有偏好，对调剂生怎么排名的，这也是大家需要去知道的。举个例子啊，土木的，如果你的本科是某某学院，基本不用去看兰州的院校了。工科前三门总分不到200的，不用去看桂林的院校。医学招调剂生的时候，他们的排名啊不太一样，就是中国医科大学主要按英语分数排，然后呢，西南地区的一些院校可能是正式英语总分来排。这些情况你主要是问目标院校的学长学姐来打听。第三，不了解调剂规则，错过机会。调剂规则中比较容易踩坑的有。一，没看院校的调剂要求你就直接申请的，大家申请某个院校之前你去看一下这个院校的调剂要求，就在调剂系统上嘛，尤其分数科目这种，如果不符合咱们就不要申请填报了，不确定你可以打研招办电话问问，别脑子一热直接就报上去提交了。提交上去的志愿是有锁定时间的，18小时、24小时、36小时都有，虽然可以联系研招办提前解锁，但不是还得费一番功夫吗？尤其有些院校的调剂要求分数科目专业限制给的很细，很可能人家是已经有联系好的学生了，就照着那些学生的情况画的，这种咱们就没必要去当分母了。二，两个志愿报了一个学校的，研招网调剂系统的规则，学校加专业方向算一个志愿嘛。然后就有同学想，如果我把一个院校的几个专业方向都报上，是不是调剂过去的几率更大？不是的，你这么做只是在浪费机会，浪费位置。大家填志愿的时候，千万别两三个志愿都填了一个学校，直接填那个学校最保险的专业一个就行。三，错过通知，错误抉择的。复试通知、待录取通知的确认是有时间限制的，逾期了，招生单位有权取消。虽然你可以跟院校沟通，让他们再给你发一下，但是人家能不能愿意再发？这个不好说啊。另外，由于一旦确定一封逆录取通知，你的调剂就结束了，不能再接受复试通知和其他逆录取通知了，因此很多同学呢，他对逆录取通知的这个抉择上就可能会影响到你最终的结果。一种是想去的还没发呢，没发待录取，甚至还你还没去复试，之前复试过的院校已经给你录取了，这就得仔细评估一下后者上岸的机会大小，你有可能得偿所愿，也有可能搏一搏路虎变摩托。另一种是一志愿和调剂院校都给了逆录取，你想去调剂的那个院校怎么办？通常一志愿默认你接受他们的逆录取，你得跟一志愿研招办沟通取消，再去接受其他逆录取。往年确实有这种情况，但今年一志愿复试啊，调剂复试它是错开的嘛，其实发生这种事的概率就不太大了啊。接下来我们说复试方面，就无论你是一志愿还是调剂，大家都得经过复试嘛。复试是容易翻盘的地方，也是容易翻车的地方，而且大家真的翻的花样百出。但归结起来，老师最后没留下你，大概率就是以下几点：一、基础不牢，这个是致命的原因。不管复试是笔试还是面试，基本的知识点你肯定不能出错，出错了很减分，但光有知识点也不行，你得由点及面啊，会分析拓展，会谈出自己的一些见解。很多同学面试的时候问到什么理论，是只知其一不知其二，只知道名字不知道内涵，只知道模型不知道应用，只知道问题不知道解决方案，这就是典型的基础不牢，就你整个框架是没有的。另外有些专业尤其社科的，很多理论是比较像的，容易混淆，不同的理论怎么演化发展，适用情境各自是什么，舶来品的理论怎么中国化啊？老师可能多问你一句你就答不上来了，他也会觉得你学的不扎实，基本不公有问题，所以一定要好好复习啊，宝子们。我基本上每期视频都会提醒大家这一点，这是你上岸特别关键的。第二种，不诚实，不懂装懂，这种一旦被面试官识别了，基本上是一票否决啊，给你面试的老师是你们领域的大佬，他的知识面肯定是比你宽很多，而且他面试了这么多年啊，那么多学生一眼就能看出你是理解错了答非所问，还是就是不懂装懂，前者可能还给你个台阶和机会，你抓住了可以补救一下，后者就凉得比较彻底了。有的老师可能性子比较直啊，当场就戳穿你的错误，这种时候你也别嘴硬， 啊，老老实实认错就好了。有的同学当时就以前有同学问我啊，说这种情况可不可以甩锅，就说我本科院校没开过这门课，或者老师没讲，来弥补一下。我的建议是不要。因为如果你拿出影帝影后级别的表演，最多也就是面试官对你的恶感小一点，但可能对你的本科有点看法。如果你演砸了，而且这个几率很大，或者人家就认识你们本科的老师们，毕竟一个圈子的，那知道情况，那这就你只能表演一下铁锅炖自己吧。第三个，逻辑不清，表达不行。研究生跟本科生的一个主要区别就是分析问题、解决问题的能力嘛。你落到面试里就是你的逻辑。大家面试时很容易犯的一个错，就是听到老师的问题还没搞清楚啊，问的啥啊，不知道是什么、为什么、怎么办，也没定位好相关的知识点就开始答了，然后想到啥说啥。这种时候老师就会觉得你可能不适合读研究生啊，因为你连基本的思维逻辑框架都没建立，那你怎么体现自己的逻辑呢？总分总、结构、组织答案、分点作答、分条陈述，就是哪怕这个问题你不懂，你都要有条理的说第一什么、第二什么、第三什么，这是在展现你的能力，就是知识可以弥补，但是能力是一定要展现。第四，专业素质不过关，你都是要读研的人了，你得让老师觉得你有基本的专业素养，怎么表现呢？多说术语、专业术语，以及你一定要展现出一种做学术的态度。大家一定要注意啊，咱们做学术不是说从被录取的那一刻开始的，或者研一才开始，你复试之前你其实要开始进入到一种做学术的那样的一个状态，至少你要让老师感受到你进入状态了。老师在面试中特别喜欢问大家毕设呀，还有科研啊，你觉得他们是想看看你又创造了什么学术垃圾吗？那肯定不是，他们实际上是在考察你对自己学科的研究方法了不了解，知不知道专业论文怎么写，一个报告分哪几步啊，有没有读过最新的学术文章，大家就是从这些方面了解你的态度、潜力这些东西的。有同学说我报的是专硕，那专硕怎么了？专硕不需要帮老师干活了是吗？专硕不需要帮老师做课题是吗？专硕就是让老师供着吗？就是大家记住啊，无论专硕学硕，老师都会希望科研能力还不错。所以你要是没有科研文章的，你务必准备好毕设，以及多看看你们领域的最新文献，最好看几篇外文的。五，复试过后泄题的，就每年都有同学复试完，在有很多人的那种大群讨论，然后就被人恶意举报了，导致拜拜，稳稳的录取没了。所以大家一定要注意啊，复试结束后谨言慎行，不然就太冤枉了。以上就是大家在上岸过程中可能遇到的种种让你前功尽弃的问题。关注我们一键三连，我们会持续分享更多复试调剂的干货信息，帮助你顺利上岸。转生转死的经管考研人，看到我们就不用愁了。这期视频是我们牛哥考研经管团队老师根据过往带过的数百个学生的上岸经验和血泪教训熬夜写的原创攻略哦，一定要好好看，以及别忘了给我个三连。经济大类的专业中，专硕主要有金融、国际商务、应用统计、税务、资产评估、审计；学硕大体包括理论经济学和应用经济学两大类。如果你发现一志愿不稳，肯定要考虑一下调剂的。想调剂，先要知道经济大类专业的基本调剂规则。首先，专硕通常只能调剂到专硕，经济类专硕专业之间是可以相互调剂的，但是由于金融、国际商务、应用统计、税务、资产评估、审计之间它的专业课的差异性啊，实际调剂中金融和国商互相调剂的情况是比较多的，其他的相对较少。第二，学硕既可以调剂到学硕类专业，也可以往专硕调，也就是说你考应用经济学专业的考生不仅可以调剂到理论经济学、应用经济学，还可以往金融、国商、税务等专业调。第三，有一些学校的专硕考试科目为数三啊，这些学校它可以接受396，还有一部分虽然接受，但是它要加试数学，也有一部分是压根不接受。所以你看上了一个学校想调，一定要打他们学院研招办电话问清楚。考396的学校呢，基本都是接受考数三调剂的。接下来我分别讲一下经济学类热门专业的调剂去向啊，主要就是金融啊、国商啊、应用经济学、理论经济学这几个专业。不同分数段的考生，你直接对号入座，看看你该往什么样的院校走。首先说金融啊，第一档400分。